Israel. After those days, says the Lord, I will put my laws into their mind. The laws of God, the commandments of God, the will of God, the demand of God upon us. It will not just be only on Sunday when you come to church. It will be in your mind all the days of your life. And when you want to go this way or go that way, or want to do this or want to do that, the law of God will be coming off from your heart as if you're winding it, and you say, no, you can't go that way, you can't do that, you can't stay like that, because this is the word of the Lord, this is the will of the Lord. It's reaching in your mind, it's put in your heart, and it says, I will put it in their mind, and then it says, and write them in their heart, and I will be, and I will be to them a God, and they shall be to me a people. It will happen. In chapter 10, I'm reading from verse 34. Chapter 10, verse 34. For ye have compassion on me in my bones, and took joyfully the spoiling of your goods. You took joyfully the spoiling of your goods. You know, the attitude of people in the old year, the old nature of the old year of the old time. Any little sin that they lost, they cried, and it's like they're not going to stop crying. You know, I lost a biro. I lost a bunch of keys. I lost this. I lost that. I lost a bicycle. Think about that. But this year, there's no crying. Yeah. If you lose a bicycle, it means a motorcycle is coming on the way. If you lose a motorcycle, it means a car is coming on the way. If you lose a car, again, who knows, free ticket for aeroplane is coming for you. That means you are saying, whatever happens this year, the word is better. Whatever happens, the word is what? It's better. And the children, if you know, they say in particular school, the door is closed, you can't come in, you smile and say, praise the Lord, a better school is coming on my way. And if you lose a little certificate, it means, praise the Lord, that God said, you are better than that. Drop that one. A better certificate is coming in Jesus' name. That's the reason why the believers over here, when they lost all those goods, they said, no problem, no problem, something better is coming. I said, something better is coming. I said, something better is coming. Look at that again. He had compassion on me in my bones, and took joyfully the spoiling of your goods, knowing in yourselves that ye have in heaven a better and an enduring substance. It says, the reason why you could rejoice is because you know there's something greater than what you have lost. Can I tell you that as you look at your life, since you are very young and you have been saying, I wish I had this, I wish I had this, I wish I had this, there's no wishing anymore, those things have come. Yeah. Verse 35, cast not away therefore your confidence, which has great recompense of reward. For ye have need of patience, perseverance, that after ye have done the will of God, ye might receive the promise. For yet a little while, and he that shall come, and will not tarry. For yet a little while, and he that shall come, and will not tarry. I need to dwell on that verse for you. Well, the primary interpretation of that, the immediate interpretation of that, is talking about Christ. We know that Christ is coming again. Have you heard that before? Yet a little while, and he that shall come and will not tarry. That is the primary interpretation. Now, the secondary interpretation. Are you ready?
Yes.
Your child that ran away from home, and you're wondering, when will this child come? Yet a little while, and he that shall come and will not tarry. Welcome that child, prepare for that child that ran away, that child is coming back. That daughter that said, mommy, leave me alone, I'm going to marry who I will. My daughter, don't do like this, you are breaking my heart. And the daughter ran away, and since she got married now, there's no information. Don't worry. And in just a little while, and she that will come and will not tarry. Your husband, that man just said, I'm fed up. Listen up. I'm leaving. Honey, don't do like this. My daddy, don't leave me alone. Just pray, pray, pray. And every time, what did Jesus say? How will Jesus do it? I'm fed up. No drinking, no smoking. I'm going. And it's gone. This is 2010. That man is coming back. Because just a little while, and he that shall come, and will not tarry. Look at your wife. Your wife, you know, just ran away somewhere and said, I will punish you. I know that you cannot marry another person because once I'm gone, it's you that will suffer. Looking for heaven, me, I will go anywhere when I die. And then you say, Pastor, pray for me. Look at my condition. Look at my age. And this woman is gone away. This year, don't worry. What did I say? I said, don't worry because yet a little while, and she that will come, and will not tarry. The business partner that took, you know, all your capital away, and then you said, look at me, I put all my savings, everything into this. They'll bring that capital back. Because he that shall come, and will not tarry in Jesus' name. I know, you know, there's a heart that is broken there. It was, you know, this combat of yours. You loved him. You loved that very much. And eventually just broke away and went to a place where they're not preaching the gospel. And you have been wondering that you have prayed, you have fasted. And the man is just out there in the wilderness of a church. And then you are saying, when will this happen? And the Lord is saying, those backsliders, they are coming back this year. Because yet a little while, and he that shall come, and will not tarry in Jesus' name. I think you must have heard me last week when I said, God is making everything new. Did you hear that? Did you connect last week? Yes, you did. And I told you that our marriage committee has now become totally new. New heart, new love, new compassion. And then you took a name there last year. And when you got there, they said, what are you looking for? They said, you know, I'm led to so and so. You're waiting for that one. That one is gone. It's now, you okay, pray for another one. And now, here you are today. And I tell you, go back to that seminary committee. And they say, what are you looking for? The pastor said, I should come back to you. What did the pastor say you should come for? The pastor said that yet a little while. And she that was gone and is coming shall come and will not tarry. And when you see the fulfillment, don't clap yet. When you see the fulfillment, you must appreciate what I've said and give me your invitation. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. You know, this year preaching is like this. Preaching with laughter, preaching with joy. It's not preaching with frowning. I'm preaching with stand up and get up. This, because this year everything is going to become better. Yeah. Preaching will be better. Yeah. Praying will be better. Yeah. Promises will be better. Yeah. When you face Sunday, you go back to my committee, better. When you go to, for work on Monday, everything better. This year is a year of joy. And now in verse 38, now the joy shall lay my faith. And if any man draw back, I will not draw back. My soul shall have no pleasure in him. But we are not of them who draw back unto perdition, but of them that believe unto the saving of the soul. I believe, and it is going to happen in Jesus' name. Because the Lord has promised great things, and those great things will come upon our lives, upon your life in Jesus' name. If you never saw a miracle in your life this year, you will see miracles. Okay, God just pours everything upon you. Say, Lord, that is enough. I've got the better thing now. And then, who knows? One Sunday, I might even allow you to give testimony on Sunday. In John chapter 14, I'm reading from verse 12. Verily I say unto you, he that believeth on me. Where are those people? Praise the Lord. God will not disappoint your faith. He that believeth on me, the works I do, he shall do also. And greater works than this shall he do, because I go unto my Father. The greater things will come upon your life in Jesus' name. Point number two. The great power of bridal tongues. This is very important as we're expecting the better things to come, the better things to experience, and the better things to have. If you don't have any good thing to say, just shut up. Don't say anything about yourself. When something happens at home, when something happens to a child, when something happens to your wife, when something happens to your husband, if you don't have any good thing to say, just shut up. Don't say anything. Don't say, you know, bad things are threatened again. Bad things will never start your life again. Don't say, isn't it better for us to go back into Egypt? You will not go back into Egypt. Don't ever say, the Assyrians have come again and they're going to destroy us. Nobody will destroy you. And don't say, I've lost it again. I've lost it. You will never lose it again. If you cannot say something good about yourself, about your wife, about your husband, about your child, about your coordinator, about your group coordinator, and about your pastor, of course, about the church, then just close your mouth and bridle that tongue, because this tongue this year is going to be a tongue of blessing. Amen. Great, the great power of bridled tongues. Look at Joshua chapter 6. Joshua chapter 6. I'm reading from verse 1. In Joshua chapter 6, reading from verse 1. Now Jericho was strictly shut up because of the children of Israel, and none went out and none came in. And the Lord said unto Joshua, see, I have given into thine hand Jericho, and the king thereof, and the mighty men of valor, and ye shall compass the city, all ye men of war, and go round about the city walls. Thus shalt thou do 6 days, and 7 priests shall bear before the ark 7 trumpets of ram's horns. And the 7th day ye shall compass the city 7 times, and the priest shall blow with the trumpet. In verse 5, and it shall come to pass that when they make a long blast with the ram's horn, and when ye hear the sound of the trumpet, All the people shall shout with a great shout, and the wall of the city shall fall down flat, and the people shall ascend up, every man straight before him. This year, Jericho walls will fall. But you know the secret of Jericho wall falling? They will just go around one day at a time, only once, and not say anything, and then on the 7th day, they go 7 times, and only at the right time, when the miracle is to take place, that's the time they shout. Look at verse 10, and Joshua commanded the people, saying, ye shall not shout, that's one, ye shall not shout, all these days bridle your tongue, hold your tongue. Don't say anything. If that is your weakness, that you always talk. Anytime you're happy, you just talk your sadness. Anytime you're sorrowful, you just talk your sorrow. Anytime you're disappointed, you just give out your disappointment. Every time there is any challenge, you just talk. This year, we're not going to talk carelessly. I said, we're not going to talk carelessly. It says, ye shall not shout, that number one, nor make any noise with your voice, that number two. He said, this is the secret of Jericho walls falling down. This is the secret of the great miracle that you have never seen. Better things happening, greater things happening, higher things happening. Number two, you will not make any noise with your voice. Number three, neither shall any word proceed out of your mouth. Neither shall any word proceed out of your mouth. You know the children of Israel, you know why many of them missed the land of Canaan? Because of their mouth, because of their tongue. They were discouraged, and then they began to speak against God and against Moses, and serpents came and destroyed many of them. There was no water to drink, and then they began to talk, what are we going to drink? Is it not good to go back to Egypt? And many of them perished. There was no food to eat. And then he said, even this man, were fed up with this, always murmuring, always complaining. And Joshua knew that the secret of getting the miracle and getting the better thing is that there must be a watch upon their mouth. And the Lord told him, he said, Joshua, you know, you and Caleb, when the 10 spies came back and he said, the giants are there, you know their difficulty. And then they began to say, let's choose a captain, we're going back, we cannot move forward anymore. Every time they're always saying the wrong thing, Joshua go and tell them that, number one, you will not shout if you're going to get the miracle. Number two, you will not make any noise at all with your voice. Number three, neither shall any word proceed out of your mouth until the day that I bid you shout, then shall ye shout. That was the instruction. And it was that bridled tongue that made the Jericho walls to fall. Look at verse 20. So the people shouted when the priest blew with the trumpets. And it came to pass when the people heard the sound of the trumpet, and the people shouted with a great shout, that the wall fell down flat. Those walls were fall. So that the people went up into the city, every man straight before him, and they took the city. You will take your possession. Nothing will hinder you this year except your tongue, that you make sure that any word of slander, any word of insult, any word of abuse, any word of deception, any word of evil, any word of iniquity, any word of criticism, any word of envy, any word of jealousy, all that you cut off, because this is a year of blessing. 2 Kings chapter 18. 2 Kings chapter 18. I'm reading from verse 28. 2 Kings chapter 18, verse 28. In verse 28, this is what it says. 2 Kings chapter 18, verse 28. In verse 28, then Rabshakeh stood and cried with a loud voice in the Jews' language and spake, saying, hear the word of the great king, the king of Assyria. Thus says the king, let not Hezekiah deceive you, for he shall not be able to deliver you out of his hand. Neither let Hezekiah make you trust in the Lord, saying, the Lord will surely deliver us, and this city shall not be delivered into the hand of the king of Assyria. Hearken not to Hezekiah. For thus says the king of Assyria, make an agreement with me by a present, and come out to me, and then eat ye every man of his own vine, and every one of his fig tree, and drink ye every one waters of his own cistern, until I come and take you away to a land like your own land, a land of corn and wine, a land of bread and vineyards, a land of oil, olive, and of honey, that ye may live and not die. And hearken not unto Hezekiah when he persuadeth you, saying, the Lord will deliver us. Here was an enemy. He said his representative, and he was telling these people of Judah, don't listen to your leader. Whatever he's saying, it doesn't deceive you. A better year, don't listen to him. A greater year, don't listen to him. This, don't listen to him. I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that. He was bragging. But look at it. And as any of the gods in verse 33 of the nations delivered at all his land out of the hand of the king of Assyria, where are the gods of Hamath or of Apart? Where are the gods of Sivavim and Hena and Ivan? Have they delivered Samaria out of my hand? Then who are they among all the gods of the countries that have delivered their country out of my hand, that the Lord should deliver Jerusalem out of my hand? Look at verse 36. And the people did what? They held their peace and answered him not a word. Quietness. Silence. Not responding, not replying the enemy. The secret of the better things, of the greater miracles the Lord wants to perform is that you keep your mouth, your bridle, your tongue, and you do not allow them to get you into conversation that will lead into unbelief, conversation that will lead into fear, conversation that will lead into argument. They just held their peace. It says in that verse 36, the people held their peace and answered him not a word. For the king's commandment was saying, answer him not. What's the result? Let's look at the result in chapter 30, chapter 19, the very next chapter. Chapter 19, verse 32. Chapter 19, verse 32. Therefore, thus says the Lord concerning the king of Assyria, he shall not come into the city, nor shoot an arrow there, nor come before it with shields, nor cast a bank against it. By the way he came, by that same way shall he return. I shall not come into this city, says the Lord, for I will defend this city. The Lord will defend our city. He will defend our church to save it for my own sake and for my servant David's sake. Look at verse 35. And it came to pass that night, when he had bragged during the day, when he had exalted himself during the day, and the people of God answered nothing. The people of God bridled their tongues. They kept quiet, which is what the Lord is telling us to do this year. That all the careless talking of last year, all the slandering of last year, all the abuse of last year, all the deception with our tongue last year, and all those white lies of last year, all those things, everything will vanish away this year. That we just bridle your tongue. It says in that verse 35, it came to pass that night that the angel of the Lord went out and smote in the camp of the Assyrians 185,000. 185,000 of their soldiers, everyone perished that night. And when they rose early in the morning, behold, they were all dead corpses. Dead corpses. Because the people listened to their king, to their leader, when he said, speak not a word, don't answer him. We're not going to answer any of those persecutors this year, any of those liars this year, any of those people bragging and saying, I'll deal with you, I'll do this, I'll do this. And then they found, they say, are you not talking? Are you not listening to me? I will do this, I will do this to you. Well, just, you know, we'll smile it away. We'll say nothing. Because we know God is on our side. He'll fight our battles for us in Jesus' name. And then they're going to be surprised that after all they're bragging and we say nothing, because we know God is defending us. It is they that will perish and we will keep and remain alive in Jesus' name.